all of us together have to be big within this. Because in the bigger picture is that it's bigger than this concert. All the people who come to see this, they're gonna make of it something totally different than what we all think about what this is tonight. We don't have the power to control how they think about this. But what we do know is what we expect of each other. And like how good this can sound and how powerful it can be. That's all I'm looking for.
Jason Moran, who's one of the most esteemed jazz pianists in the world, winner of a MacArthur Fellowship, has been commissioned by Symphony Center to create a new work. And he's decided for this new piece to involve the Kenwood Academy Jazz Band. So these kids, from age 12 to 18, these kids, many of whom have never even been in orchestra halls at Symphony Center, are going to find themselves playing on the stage in front of more than 2,000 people for the first time in their lives. And Jason has created a work that places them at the center of the piece.
Any kid that decides to play an instrument is serious. Any kid that also is in high school and continues to decide, I'm going to be a part of this jazz band. That's amazing dedication. And I have utmost respect for students who decide to do that, because I was one of those students who decided to do that. And I wanted to kind of genuinely bow to them by inviting them onto the stage with me at the CSO.
It's good for the students to have that type of exposure, most importantly, of course, and also for the school. You know, it's just a great opportunity. We couldn't pass it by.
So they have to play up to a concert level, and that's something that of a sort that they've never done before. In addition to which, Jason is collaborating with Theastra Gates, an internationally known Chicago visual artist and social activist. Plus, another MacArthur fellow, Ken Vandermark, is also participating in the project.
Bringing together the students with Ken Vandermark, my bandwagon, Katie Ernst as a singer.
The moon, it shows me.
You know, she's 24 and 25 years old, and she came to D.C. and, you know, really amazed me at the Betty Carter Jazz Ahead program at the Kennedy Center. So these people I thought were people to highlight in this city.
There is so much blood.
And then Theastra Gates is, you know, making these objects. So he made a series of music stands for the students to play on.
Play it again. Hold it steady.
And he made a very long sculptural music stand, which will serve an important role in the piece. So it's a stage full of objects. It's a stage full of histories. It's a stage full of memories, you know. It's a stage full of sounds, all from different, you know, drawers of Chicago's history. And then there are instruments with histories too. So I'm sourcing a upright player piano from Lucas Pianos, you know. I'm still sourcing my pump organ. So there's lots of histories coming into one place at one time.
In all my decades of writing about music in Chicago, I've never seen a high school band have an opportunity like this or be faced with this kind of challenge. Last summer, Jason Moran was playing the Chicago Jazz Festival, and while he was there, he ran into one of his heroes. The great Chicago jazz pianist, Willie Pickens, who's 83 years old and playing as brilliantly as ever.
I ran into Willie Pickens, you know, because he's always out listening, and he's always out being just like also extremely positive as a, you know, as an elder statesman of the music. And we had a beautiful conversation, and at the end of it, he said, oh, you know, my daughter works with these kids at Kenwood Academy, and they're playing tomorrow afternoon, and you should come see them, man. They're gonna play one of her pieces. And I went to sleep, and I woke up the next day, and I was in my hotel, and I was like, you know what, I told Willie Pickens I was gonna go, I need to go. So I got out of bed, and I got over there, and they were just starting, and I sat down, and I listened to them play in the tent, and I was like, oh, wow, these kids are serious.
And he started talking to the kids in the band, signing autographs, taking pictures, and he told Bethany, I'll be back. I'll be back, I'm coming back. And he really decided to come back, but in a bigger way than anyone anticipated or expected. Because when Jason Moran got this commission from Orchestra Hall at Symphony Center to create a world premiere, he decided, I'm doing it with the Kenwood Jazz Band.
October, I get an email from him saying, you know, the date is May 30th, so at Symphony Center. So that was pretty exciting. I was happy to relay that to our department chair and director of our bands, Mr. Gerald Powell, and he was happy as well. And so this is an exciting opportunity for the kids.
In a way, this whole story begins with Willie Pickens, because if not for Willie Pickens, you might not and probably would not have a Kenwood Academy jazz band at this level. Willie Pickens started the jazz band program at Kenwood Academy in the late 1960s.
The school was not built at the time that I was teaching there. In fact, we broke ground for the school to be built, and the old Mayor Daley came out, and I had my little small ensemble out there. We played the Star Spangled Banner, and they'd only been studying with me for about 6 months, you know.
That's really important, because Willie Pickens is now and was then a very well-known, highly respected artist. Now he's a world-renowned artist. So from the outset, Kenwood Academy is way up on top and builds from there. In a way, Jason Moran is becoming a kind of center of gravity, a center of gravity in jazz today. You could compare it in a way, and I don't want to get too grandiose, but you could compare it in a way to Wynton Marsalis. Wynton is about 52 years old. He's artistic director of jazz at Lincoln Center. He's a force in jazz. He doesn't just compose and play, but he presents the music on a high level. Well, that is what Jason is doing at the Kennedy Center in Washington, D.C. And the Kennedy Center is the busiest performing arts center in the United States and one of the busiest in the world. He's organizing jazz there. In addition to that, he happens to be a great pianist and an innovative pianist.
You might be wondering who this is. Next to me, that's a mask of Fats Waller that I'll eventually wear.
Samples music, he gets into contemporary music a little. So his reach is wide, his tastes are broad. And he's bringing all that force and all that stature, and not to mention being a MacArthur Fellowship winner, to a high school on the south side of Chicago.
And Jason is doing very interesting things about trying to make the music not a museum piece. And I think this mixed media, you know, multidiscipline thing that he's incorporated with the project that he brought here, is a very interesting way to place music that's connected to jazz history and show that it's a vibrant, living thing, not a museum piece.
I'm not trying to make the largest statement in the world, but I think as a collective, we can really make a powerful one.
That's everybody who's playing. It's got to go all the way up there, too. You got to shoot sound. It's not just shooting sound to play the notes that's 1 foot in front of you.
Kids have a really beautiful ability of tapping into where they are and remarking on it. That's what makes grown-ups afraid of going into high schools, talking to high school students. It's because they know the high school students don't really have a filter. They'll let you know how they feel.
All of these kids are different in a way. They are voluntarily in jazz band. That's not what most kids their age, high school age, are doing. That's not the music you hear on the radio. It's not the music you see on TV. It's really not the music in our popular culture. But something about this music has attracted them to it.
My mom and I used to listen to it like when she picked me up from school when I was really young, like first grade. So jazz has been kind of like in my life for a long time.
And what do you think you like about it? What do you like about that music?
I just love the soul and how you can tell a story and you can hear a story through jazz.
I actually started, an intermediate band. I heard the jazz band play, and they're playing soprano saxophone, and I love the sound. I think they're playing These Are My Favorite Things, and I loved it, and I wanted to play soprano saxophone, so I asked Mr. Powell, and he said the only way I can play soprano saxophone is to be in the jazz band.
One, two, ready.
In concert music, I didn't feel like, it's not really yourself, I guess. You can be yourself in jazz band and you can express yourself a lot easier.
Ever since I started jazz band, like, I actually found new appreciation for music itself. At first I had just a limited view of music, hip hop, R&B, that's pretty much it. Now with jazz, I pretty much listen to anything, and I'm like, that sounds nice.
Trumpet I've been playing for about 4.5 years.
And why the trumpet?
Because actually my father also played trumpet and his grandfather played trumpet. It's a very free instrument. It's like, it gives you freedom to do a lot of things sound wise and like as far as technical wise. I plan to become a professional musician. I don't know what college I'm going to yet, but I plan to major in music performance and music education as well. And then hopefully come out and that have a paying job right off the bat, because I know the musician business is very hard.
Over the course of 3 months, you could see this dramatic improvement, and it was a long journey and a difficult journey. The first piece that they started to learn, was Wabash Stomp, written and recorded in 1937 by Roy Eldridge, who was an iconic Chicago trumpeter. And who's generally regarded as the bridge between Louis Armstrong and Dizzy Gillespie. And so they're playing his music. They went to YouTube in class, they listened to it on YouTube, the recording, and then they tried to duplicate it and they didn't have the sense or the feel about it. And this weeks and weeks of going over, it just was kind of eluding them. And I don't think they had the big breakthrough moment until a Skype session with Jason Moran, where Jason was in his apartment in New York, the kids were in the band room, and they're going over the music together, and then Jason has them do kind of a hip hop rhythm on another piece of his called Big News. And then Jason makes this remarkable statement.
Can we go back to Wabash Stomp and you play that same rhythm that the drums is playing? Can you play Wabash Stomp with that beat?
Let's take that rhythm from Big News, that hip-hop rhythm, and put it on top and underneath Wabash Stomp. And when they did that, it kind of took off like a rocket. Suddenly they were playing the rhythm that they knew that miraculously fit in with Wabash style because it's all of the same sort.
It's kind of more modern than other things that we play, so yeah. It's kind of interesting to play that stuff as a whole band.
There's not one kid in this band who does not think about the violence that's happening on the south side of Chicago, which is where they live. These kids roam across various areas as they go to lessons, as they go to play soccer, as they go to various activities. They're all touched by this.
I live on the south side of Chicago, so it's like I live in that environment, but every day it's like I have to still continue to go on with what I have to do and get what I need to get done, complete. So it's like I just keep moving forward and I try not to involve myself or think about it as much.
Aaron, I absolutely adored Aaron. Mainly because he was such a new person to the jazz band. Like when he first came in, I was so curious as to who he was. And after hearing him play, like stereotypically, when you first look at him, you don't expect him to sound so amazing and so talented as he is. And when he starts playing, like I was completely blown away. I was not expecting that at all. He was so quiet, his friends called him Silence. And I understand why, because he barely said anything. He barely spoke. But he definitely spoke volumes when he was playing the guitar. It was really nice knowing him. I really wish we could have been in the band more because he has so much potential and, you know, I could see him being something great. I didn't get to go to his funeral, unfortunately. We definitely have someone to play for now.
When Chicago pops up into your news feed in a way, when it pops up into mine, it pops up in, you know, this many shootings this weekend. What I didn't want myself to focus on in this piece was that. Because it's so pervasive already. And when I talk about light, I wanted to highlight the lights that are in the city. There will be a moment in this piece that will overtly deal with it. Music for me has served as a therapeutic way to deal with so much. And in African American history, it has always been a part of our coping mechanism. And so I use this concert as a way to cope with all that tense struggle, pain, despair, you know, that people kind of endure.
And each one of the kids, in one way or another, to one degree or another, told me that Kenwood Academy in general, and the band room in specific, is a kind of a sanctuary for them, a refuge.
We're always filled with kids who are doing positive things, you know, other than shooting themselves, you know. And so a lot of times those things get overlooked, and this is a great opportunity to show something positive.
The most dramatic progress that the students made were in those last few days. There was a last rehearsal with Jason at Kenwood, and he did something very interesting. He wrote down on the blackboard the words to the Schubert song, Der Doppelganger, with lyrics by Heinrich Heine. And he wanted them to understand what this sad, sorrowful song is about, so much that he made them recite the poem, the lyrics, aloud.
When Giancarlo and I first saw the music, when we first printed it out, we were like, whoa, we're not really playing anything but whole notes. But when we started playing it, and when Ken came in, he played over us, we were just like, oh, okay, like this is good.
We're here together, right? And all these people, all these cameras, f*** them.
Then they had the big dress rehearsal on May 29th. They were awestruck to be in this room. Many of them had never been in orchestra hall. But even the day before the performance, they did not know how these segments that they had learned would fit into some kind of a whole.
We all came
to the short amount of rehearsal time, very prepared with our component. And then the rehearsal was where we could all just kind of see how it all fit together and see how we would all play together in that space. We all did get to rehearse in the Symphony Center for our rehearsals, which I think also helped to make everything feel comfortable and cohesive, is that our rehearsals involved the space that we were going to be playing in.
How did the rehearsal go, you think?
I think it went very well. We're pretty tight on all the things, so yeah, I think it'll be a good concert, a great concert.
It's like an overwhelming feeling, like, oh my God, it's Symphony Center, and we're like minutes away. The sound, like, coming back at you, it's amazing, because it's like, it's the way the sound resonates in the whole auditorium.
I'm extremely excited to see, like, the final production of everything. Get to hear the singers, Ken playing, which is really fantastic since I'm also a saxophone player. So it's something I've been waiting to hear.
I'm feeling pretty good. I'm confident. I'm not shaky. My nerves are not getting to me. I'm feeling pretty awesome.
How could you hear everything okay?
If I get to do another concert at the Chicago Symphony Orchestra, I can start saying that now. Oh, I did that Chicago Symphony Orchestra. That ain't nothing.
I just feel so amazed and wonderful, you know, walking through, going on the stage before, like, they're setting everything up.
Can I just take the music with you instead of taking a whole piece?
And walking backstage and seeing Ricardo Muti's door, I definitely feel like my mom is going to be out in the audience crying. yeah, I just feel like a lot is going to change tonight. I went to Symphony Center for the first time to see the CSO, and I think third grade. And I said then, you know, one day I'm going to be playing on the stage, and today is that day I'm actually playing on the stage.
I feel this is going to be a piece of performing art. So there'll be, music will be a component of it, but there's going to be some visual art, obviously, with the astrogates involved with it.
It's called Looks of a Lot. And taken from a phrase of a rapper here in Chicago, who, when he showed up to his show and there were a lot of police there and the blue lights, and he said,
"Did you expect this?"
Yeah, just by the looks of a lot of blues.
So the Looks of a Lot is about that space of energy that is both positive but also has a dark side to it too. So I'm presenting pieces kind of in tandem with other pieces, curating in pieces by other composers.
You ghostly comrade, why do you ape the pain of my love that tormented me upon this same spot?
So, say Schubert's The Doppelganger plays an important space in it.
Oh, you doppelganger, you pale comrade, why do you ape the pain of my love?
We used parts of it throughout the entire concert, played in different ways over and over again. We used Roy Eldridge's homage to Chicago with Wabash style, you know. I So I used these pieces, but then I wrote these pieces. I wrote new pieces too.
Shoulder to Shoulder, it's one of my favorite songs we played tonight. Gorgeous, because the song is beautiful in itself, and you know, a lot of the saxophones are leaving this year. It just kind of made me reflect on all the times we had together, starting from last year when I first came to Kenwood. You know, all the concerts we did, all the contests, all the arguments we've had and made up, and all the friendships we've built that are probably going to last for the rest of our lives.
And the music that Jason brought in, you know, was music that was exciting for them to play, was original, and that they could execute. The best performing they did was at the gig, which to me, that's a musician. You know, I mean, that's a real, the spirit of a musician is like, whatever happens, happens. You know, you try to make the rehearsals great and whatnot. But when you get in the room and the gig's on, that's the music. And they played unbelievably well at the show.
I think that the sooner that we can expose students, whether they become professional musicians or not, to the experience of performing, being in a big, beautiful performance space, being part of something bigger than what they could ever imagine, is life-changing and essential. I wish that we could do this every year.
This performance has solidified my belief in this music and belief in the path that I'm going to travel after I graduate from high school. I want to be like doing things like this along with like with the same kind of process, like playing with students from like schools around the country.
One of the things that struck me most was the nature of the leaps that these students made. Because in the rehearsal room, it sounded like bits and pieces. It did not sound like a whole piece of music. And from the rehearsal room at school, to the rehearsal here, to the sound check, to the performance, each time was a major step forward. And not until they took the stage tonight did this become a real performance. And the question was, would those rehearsals really add up to a real performance? And would those students make the notes on the page into something bigger than that? And I was struck by how they did that. When I saw this piece tonight, I realized that the real stars of this show were those students. Not only because they had so much stage time, because the piece really was about them, mostly about them. And if they had not done what they did, this piece would have fallen apart into 10 different pieces, and I don't think it did.
Kids did great. The kids were on it. And the kids exceeded my goals. They knew what they were supposed to do. The beautiful part is those kids, I mean, from February to now, they have the personalities that I met the first time I was in there, you know? And a few of them are bona fide leaders, you know? It's very clear. You know, you play this and then it goes out and those people, the thousands of people that will hear this, they take this music. We don't own it anymore. Like, they have it. And you let it go. And people hopefully will get impacted by it.